Father, once again, we thank you that we are able to gather together in person and online to share in worship to you. Lord, we ask you to make us very aware of your presence with each and every one of us. Draw us together in the bonds of your love as you make your risen presence felt. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Thanks, Nick. Do sit down. Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. So again, we will listen and watch the... Okay, what have we got going up there? Can't see what it's saying, so... Just click yes. It's not actually showing on that. That's great. Click the carriage return, Nick, and see what that does. Just the enter button and see if that will... Okay, well, those of us in church still see the words. What happened? Those of you at home are very fortunate. You can see everything that's on the screen. Those in church have got a box in the middle of what they're trying to read. So hopefully it won't spoil things too much. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. Let us therefore rejoice by putting away all malice and evil and confessing our sins with a sincere and true heart. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and unbelief. We have lived for this world. Okay, we'll go back. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you your sins, and bring you to everlasting life. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Risen Christ, for whom no door is locked, no entrance barred, open the doors of our hearts, that we may seek the good of others and walk the joyful road of sacrifice and peace, to the praise of God the Father. Amen. Thank you, Tina.
The Old Testament reading is from Exodus, chapter 14, verses 10 to 31, and chapter 15, verses 20 to 21. The Israelites crossed the Red Sea. As Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians, marching after them. They were terrified and cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Did we say to you in Egypt, 'Leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians'? It would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the desert." Moses answered his people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. The Egyptians you see today, you will never see again. The Lord will fight for you. You will need to be still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to move on. Raise your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea to divide the water so that the Israelites can go through the sea on dry ground. I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so they will not go in after them. And I will gain glory through Pharaoh and all the army, through his chariots and his horsemen. The Egyptians will know that I am the Lord when I gain glory through Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen." Then the angel of the Lord, who had been traveling in front of Israel's army, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood behind them, coming between the armies of Egypt and Israel. Throughout the night, the cloud brought darkness on one side and light on the other, so neither went near the other all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of the fire and cloud at the Egyptian army and threw it into a confusion. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, "Let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing towards it, and the Lord swept them into the sea. The water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not one of them survived. But the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on their right and their left. That day the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servant. Then Miriam the prophet, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women followed her with tambourines and dancing. Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he is highly exalted. Both horse and driver he has hurled into the sea." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is Acts 4, verses 32 to 35. The believers share their possessions. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all, that there was no needy person among them. From time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them and brought the money from the sales and put it at the feet of the apostles, and it was distributed to anyone who had need. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, alleluia. I am the first and the last, says the Lord, and the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to Christ our Saviour. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." He said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord. Thanks, Jen.
Today's gospel reading begins in an atmosphere of fear. It's the evening of Easter Sunday, only 2 days after the death of Jesus. The disciples are inside the house with the doors firmly locked because they're terrified that as companions of Jesus, they too will be liable to be arrested and punished. The words of assurance they'd been given earlier are now all forgotten. Suddenly, there is Jesus standing in their midst. The very fact that he can be present in spite of the locked doors indicates that he's not the same as before, that he's present in a new way. "Peace be with you," is his greeting. It's the normal Jewish greeting of shalom. But coming from Jesus, the Prince of Peace, to this group of frightened people, it has special meaning. And in the Greek, there is no verb, so it can be taken either as a wish or a statement of fact. Where Jesus is truly present to us, there is peace. He shows them his hands and his side. He's not just a disembodied ghost, but the same Jesus who died on the cross. And yet, there are differences. The disciples' fear is gradually transformed into an unspeakable joy at the return of their master. He continues to speak to them, repeating his greeting of peace. He proceeds to give them their mission. There's no critical word of their failure to stand by him in his final moments. Instead, he says, "As the Father sent me, so am I sending you." Then he breathed on them, the breath of life. Reminiscent of God breathing on the dust, on the earth. Reminiscent of God breathing on the dust of the earth and creating human life in the first man. It's also the breath of the Spirit of the Father and of the Son. Receive the Holy Spirit. Then comes their mission. For those whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. For those whose sins you retain, they are retained. Is that all he gives them to do? It doesn't seem much. What about all the other things the gospel talks about? And yet, it's all there in those words. There is no full forgiveness of sin without reconciliation. Their task is to bring about the reconciliation of all with their God. with their brothers and sisters, and with the whole of creation. It can be summed up as justice, peace, and the integrity of creation. That is their primary mission, to which all their other efforts and teaching will be subordinated. To restore right relationships between God and his people, and among the people themselves. That's a pretty big job in itself. In practice, it involves a lot more than just saying words of forgiveness. It involves much more than confessing our sins and being absolved. It involves working to create a whole society based on right relationships with God, between people and with the rest of creation. It's the making of the kingdom of God. And that is a massive task. Their mission is also ours. The words of Jesus spoken to them are also spoken to us. And this is very well expressed in the description of the ideal Christian community that we find in the reading from Acts. The whole group of believers was united, heart and soul. This is the unity of community and fellowship. No one claimed for their own use anything they had, as everything they owned was held in common. Or, in the Marxist version, to each according to his need, from each according to his ability. No individualistic greed and competitiveness that's prevalent in today's societies. As a result, none of their members was ever in want, because those who had wealth gave it to the community. It was then distributed to any members who might be in need. Can we find that today anywhere in the church? Well, actually, yes. It's present in communities of religious life where it is properly lived out. But it needs to be lived more widely among all Christians. The basic Christian community and other forms of lay community are living it out and moving in that direction. I guess over the past year, with the pandemic and the issues it's thrown up, we've had a better insight, a window into what living in a community really means. It was called the spirit of the Blitz in wartime, and we've witnessed that same spirit in countless ways over the past 12 months. The unity of community and fellowship. People helping those in need. Individualistic greed replaced by sharing, unselfish acts, and caring. Unless, of course, it involved toilet rolls or pasta. The national outpouring of grief at the death of Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh. A nation coming together in community and fellowship. The ideal Christian community being lived out by many who would not see themselves as Christian. But God works through people, whether they recognize it as God or not. Now, on that day, one apostle was missing, Thomas. And when he was told that by his companions that they'd seen the Lord, he said he wouldn't believe it unless he saw with his own eyes the marks of the wounds and put his hands in the wound in Jesus' side. And then 1 week later, today in fact, they were all, including Jesus, including Thomas, gathered together in the room. Although the doors were locked, Jesus was suddenly there among them, just as before. And after the usual greeting of peace, He invited Thomas not just to look, but to touch the wounds in his hands and his side. Do not doubt any longer, but believe. Thomas yields completely to the experience, my Lord and my God. It's one of the most powerful of acknowledgements of Jesus' true identity in the whole gospel, and incidentally, the only time anyone directly calls Jesus God. Ironically, too, it's an act of faith. Thomas couldn't see directly that Jesus was God. No one can see God directly, but the experience convinced Thomas that he was in the presence of God himself. The following words of Jesus are meant to encourage us, all who have not had Thomas's experience. Happy are those who have not seen and yet believe. We too need to be always open to experiences where God's unmistakable presence can be recognized. And finally, we're reminded that everything that is in the gospel is to help us to come to that stage in faith by which we believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief, we may find life. And I think that's a good place to be. It's healthy to have a bit of doubt because it keeps us searching and looking for God. And in doing so, we grow closer to God. We don't become complacent. John's Gospel tells us that there are lots of signs that Jesus is our Lord and our God. Many that are written in the Gospel and many more that are not. We may not yet have reached the point that Thomas ends up at. We may not yet be able to say with him that Jesus is Lord. But if we have reached the place Thomas starts from, if we are willing to believe but not yet convinced, then we shouldn't be afraid to start to look for those signs. The signs on the road to faith are there for us all to see. And if we ask God with a true heart, he will help us to find them. Untold numbers of people have tried this and found that this is altogether true. They have found in following Christ a meaning, a direction, and a very special quality to their lives, which can't be found anywhere else. May that be our experience too. Amen.
Thanks, Jim. Diana, thank you.
Let us pray.
Stop.
Heavenly Father, in this Easter season, may we rejoice in the glory of the risen Lord Jesus Christ, who defeated the sting of death and gave us all the promise of eternal life. As we as a nation mourn the death of Prince Philip, let us give thanks for a life well lived in the service of this country. We ask you to comfort Elizabeth, our Queen, and all his family as they mourn the loss of our husband, father, grandfather, and great-grandfather. Comfort also all those for whom his death has stirred memories of loved ones who have died during this past year. We give them back to you, O God, those whom you gave to us. You did not lose them when you gave them to us, and we do not lose them by their return to you. Your Son has taught us that life is eternal and love cannot die. Open our eyes to see more clearly and draw us closer to you, that we may know that we are nearer to our loved ones who are with you. Your name be hallowed. Your kingdom come. The risen Lord Jesus announced peace to his disciples. Breathe into your church the Holy Spirit. Give faith for doubt and boldness to proclaim the good news of the kingdom throughout the world. And we particularly pray for those churches doing that in areas where they are persecuted. Your name be hallowed. Your kingdom come. Bring peace to the world. Give the leaders of the nations a desire for harmony and justice. And give courage and hope to all those working for peace. And we especially pray for peace in Myanmar and again in Northern Ireland. Your name be hallowed.
Your kingdom come.
Bring peace to our communities. Give us all a spirit of generosity and open our hearts to share of our riches and of our poverty. Your name be hallowed.
Your kingdom come.
Bring peace to all those in need of your healing, especially those suffering from the long-term effects of the COVID virus and those whose treatment has been delayed because of the pandemic. We especially pray for those members of our church family that we know and those known to us individually. Your name be hallowed.
Your kingdom come.
And a prayer from the Mothers Union. God Almighty, we praise your name this joyful Eastertide. We thank you, Lord, because through your death and resurrection, we have won the victory and your redeeming grace and love. Loving Father God, fill us with new life so that we may love one another and do what you want us to do in sharing your love with those who don't know you. In Jesus' name we pray. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thanks, Nick. We'll go past these next two slides, please. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
With you.
So, from where you are, offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you all. And with you at home. Bless you.
Open our
The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit, that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who
art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth
as it is in heaven. Give us
this day our
daily bread.
And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
To you, Lord, turn face toward you
and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you
and be gracious to you.
The Lord turn his face toward you
and give you peace.
Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and their children, and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. Raise favor, be upon you,
and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and their children,
and their children. Raise favor, be upon you,
and a thousand generations,
in your family, in your children,
in their children,
in their children.
May his presence go before you, and behind you, and beside you, all around you, and within you. He is with you, he is with you, in the morning, in the evening, in
So we pray. Lord God, our Father, through our Saviour Jesus Christ, you have assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the death of sin and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Amen. There you have our notices for the week ahead. The midweek meetings, of course, all on Zoom. And next Sunday, once again, back here in church for those who are able to join us, and also on Zoom. One thing I did want to say, before I forget it again, is how wonderful the flowers still look after a week. The ones which Jill did for us around the candle, and the ones which Jean did for us, which are back there. Thank you again for those, because they really do help to make the church look even more lovely as we're gathering back in here. Are there any other notices that we need to give particularly this morning? Okay. If we were more tech savvy with the video and everything else, we could edit out that little faux pas that some of you may have noticed at the end of the administration. I know Tina saw. Rule 101, remove the visor before you try and eat the wafer. Because it doesn't work otherwise. Okay, thanks, Nick. La, 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 la.
Light of the world, I don't. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no name of man, could ever rob me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home.
To say I aspire to a voice and a beard like the guy I had. God the Father, by whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you to walk with him in his risen life, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and with all whom you love, now and always. Amen. God has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and has given us a place with the saints in light. You have received the light of Christ. Walk in this light all the days of your life. We will shine as a light in the world to the glory of God the Father. Let us go in the light and peace of Christ. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen.